Welcome to the Bethel Park TV Art Exhibition, where we will be featuring many facets of art and many talented artists from our community. My name is Patricia Anthony, and I hope to bring beautiful and inspiring art into your home. I hope you enjoy our show. Today we are going to Cefalo's restaurant in Carnegie, Pennsylvania. Cefalo's not only has excellent food, but magnificent stained glass windows, because Cefalo's restaurant was formerly a church. They have renovated the church on the inside to be a beautiful, upscale restaurant and nightclub, but they have maintained the integrity of the windows. Kathleen Cefalo, one of the co-owners, has graciously agreed to take us on the tour and also explain some of the symbolisms of these windows. I know you will enjoy the show. You will marvel at the color and the artistry. Thank you.
Hello, and welcome to Cefalo's Restaurant, Lounge, and Banquet Center. We are located at 428 Washington Avenue, Carnegie, at the Carnegie Heidelberg exit off the Parkway West. This is the site of the former Christ United First Presbyterian Church, first dedicated in 1889. This building was renovated, expanded, and remodeled during the years of 1908 to 1913. I'm Kathleen Cefalo, and I invite you to join me on a brief tour of the magnificent, wonderful stained glass windows which fill this building and the art on the walls. We purchased this building 4 years ago when we fell in love with these fabulous windows. All that I know about stained glass art and Christian symbolism has been self-taught, and I am in no way an expert on these subjects. I can tell you that these windows make coming to work each day an experience filled with awe and appreciation. The origins of the first stained glass windows are lost in history. Stained glass windows, as we know them, seem to arise when substantial church building began. Stained glass windows are often viewed as translucent pictures. Gothic stained glass windows are a complex mosaic of bits of colored glass joined with lead into an intricate pattern illustrating biblical stories and saints' lives. While the methods and styles of stained glass windows changed throughout the centuries, there was revival of the Gothic architecture in the mid-1800s, and art historians and scientists rediscovered the medieval glass techniques. John Lafarge and Louis Comfort Tiffany were two American painters who began experimenting with glass. They worked independent from one another, but they were both trying to develop a glass that possessed a wide range of visual effects without painting. They became competitors. Lafarge developed and copyrighted opalescent glass in 1879. Tiffany made it popular, and his name became synonymous with opalescent glass and the American glass movement. Lafarge and Tiffany used intricate cuts and richly colored glasses within detailed flowing designs. Plating or layering glass layers achieved depth and texture. Lafarge died in 1910, and interest in opalescent glass waned. Tiffany remained its last defendant until his death in 1933. New craftsmen such as Willem Willett, Rambosch, Nicolai D'Assenzo, and Charles Connick made windows for churches across America. The windows in this building are believed to be the work of one of these great artists, Charles J. Connick. Born in 1875, Charles Connick was early on drawn to art. His family moved to Pittsburgh when he was 8 years old. They were poor, but Pittsburgh was booming, quickly becoming the industrial giant of the country. He began working with Horace Rudy of Rudy Brothers in 1894. He worked there for 3 years and remained in Pittsburgh directories listed as an artist and designer until 1899. He went to Boston, but returned to Pittsburgh in 1902. Connick returned to Rudy Brothers. He is known to have designed windows for churches in the Pittsburgh area. We are still trying to research the records of the Rudy Brothers studio during the construction of this building. However, records from more than 100 years ago are scarce and difficult to find. At present, we are in touch with the Charles J. Connick Foundation, hoping to verify the authenticity of the artist from records kept within their organization. The window you are viewing right now is in one of the two vestibules of this church. Most churches are built with some kind of spire or tower. The two spires of this building represent the Lord as God and man. The window you are now seeing contains two versions of the Christian cross. On the left is a version of the Rogue Cross, a monogram of Christ. And on the right is the St. John's or Maltese cross. The vestibule on the other side of this building contains a mirror window, but each panel contains a different cross. This window measures approximately 3.5 feet wide by 8.5 feet tall. This is the area where we serve our meals and provide live entertainment. Behind this stage curtain is the stained glass window, which can now only be seen from the outside. Under the curtain now exists an 18-foot screen where we show Super Bowls and hockey playoff games, as well as video presentations and original Pittsburgh-produced movies. As you can see, there are 6 massive windows which still can be viewed. Each of these main windows contains 2 angels, and beneath each angel is a Christian symbol. On the right of this window, you can see a cluster of grapes, which is symbolic of Holy Communion and the blood of Christ. To the left is the lotus, a blossom of exquisite beauty and purity. It symbolizes the purity of Christ. We believe that during World War II, these windows were coated with a black paint so as to black them out from light in case of an air raid attack. The same thing was discovered at the Grand Concourse, which was the main railway hub for the city of Pittsburgh. The left side of this window shows a cross and crown. This symbolizes Christ's triumph over death. It is often interpreted as symbolizing the reward in heaven, the crown, coming after the trials of this life, the cross. To the right, you will see the anchor cross. This is a sign of Christian hope. These windows in this part of the building measure 6 feet wide and 12 feet high. There are 2 crosses again depicted in this window, and I have been unable to name the cross seen on the left panel of this window. If one of you viewers has any information on this particular cross, I would appreciate your thoughts. The cross on the right is known as a Patronse cross. The 3 petals at each end represent the Trinity, and the total of all 12 petals represents the apostles. This window contains a depiction of 2 Christian crosses. This is a smaller window in this part of the building. If you look at the cross on the right panel, you can see that it resembles an anchor. In early Christianity, Christians were being persecuted, and so many of them were afraid to show real crosses. And so many of them would use the cross and then put the anchor at the bottom of it, the flow and curve of the anchor at the bottom of it. Other Christians would identify it as a Christian symbol, and those who were not Christian would look at it and think that it was an anchor. This is a particularly beautiful window. The left panel contains the pelican. According to legend, in a time of famine, a mother pelican would pierce her own chest and drawing her own blood, she would feed her chicks. She would eventually die. If you look closely, you will see this pelican feeding her two chicks in their nest. This is a symbol of the voluntary shedding of Christ's blood on the cross. On the right side of this window, a lamb is represented. In Christian symbolism, the lamb represents Jesus, the Lamb of God. When the lamb is standing with a banner, as this lamb is, it represents the risen Christ and his triumph over death. The left side of this window contains a lily. This is an Easter lily. Note the pure white color of the flower, which is symbolic of Christ's purity. The right side of this window contains the pomegranate. The pomegranate is a symbol of the resurrection and hope of eternal life, immortality. It can also symbolize royalty and the church, where the seeds represent the many believers who make up the one church. The pomegranate symbol derives from the ancient myth of Proserpina and her annual return to the earth in the spring. Christianity adopted this theme with the pomegranate associated with the resurrection of Christ and of believers instead of the annual resurrection of crops. The seed bursting forth from the pomegranate are also likened to Christ bursting forth from the tomb. In Christian art, the pomegranate is often held by the Christ child in depictions of the Madonna and child, such as Botticelli's Madonna of the Pomegranate. This room is used for private dining and private parties and small weddings. It contains windows with a different style of stained glass art and technique. These windows are known as figure windows. If the camera can get close enough, you will see that these windows have been layered with glass. The figures stand out about a half an inch from the background glass, and different layers of glass have given shape and color to them. They also contain black painting and shading, mostly in the faces, which has been embedded into the glass. The two windows in this room are known as the children's windows, so named because they depict the favorite Bible stories of children. This window is titled Adoration of the Magi. We see Joseph with a protecting arm around Mary, upon whose lap rests the Christ child. The halos, or circles drawn behind the heads of figures in Christian art, represent holiness. The halo surrounding the Christ child has three bars in it, and this halo signifies a member of the Trinity. Beneath the child, we once again see the lilies, signifying purity, and the lamb representing sacrifice, and the three wise men, Malachar, Balthasar, and Caspar. Behind Joseph, you will note the cedar trees, which are often seen in Christian art and symbolize consecration. This next window is titled, Suffer the Little Children to Come Unto Me. Here we see Christ. Again, notice the three bars on his halo, representing a member of the Trinity. A mother and her two children. The little girl on the right is offering Christ white daisies. The daisies developed in the 15th century as a symbol of Jesus in his humanity and humbleness. And accompanying the daisies is a stem of Lily of the Valley, which often represents Advent or the coming of Christ. Again, please note the background. Behind these figures, the sky with clouds, the tall tree, the buildings with eaves and arches and steps, and again, the cedar trees. We are now entering our banquet hall, where we do hold weddings, private parties, private events, rehearsal dinners, showers, and wakes. Attached to this room is a room known as the Pyramid Room. We are now in the Pyramid Room, so named because of the angles of its walls. This room is usually the host to bridal cakes and cookies or additional seating for banquets and parties. The window you are now looking at is called the Presentation of Jesus at the Temple to Simeon. Simeon holds the Christ child, while Joseph holds the sacrifice of two white doves, as the law required. White doves often represent the Holy Spirit. In this window, note that the halos surrounding the Holy Family do not bear the three bars. This window is entitled Jesus in the Temple. Here Jesus is seen as a 12-year-old, amazing the rabbis with his wisdom. Please notice the draperies in the temple and the amazing sunset sky outside. All of these figure windows show the figures done in half-inch relief with the original stained glass panel behind them. Right now we're in our kitchen. As you can see from all the equipment around here, we have, to my knowledge, the only kitchen in the city of Pittsburgh that hosts four magnificent stained glass windows. And I like to think that these windows inspire our chefs to create fabulous food art. Now we come to my favorite windows in the building. These are our figure windows, as you can see. This window in front of you is called Faith, and the figure is raised up the half inch from the stained glass beneath it. The three windows which you're about to see are also known as series windows. They feature Faith, Hope, and Charity, the three virtue windows. This is Faith. My desk is just to the left of this. Faith is holding an oil lamp. In the Old Testament, oil was a sign of consecration to God. And the oak tree in the background is a symbol of steadfastness, especially in times of trial and persecution. The size of this window is 4 feet wide and 8 feet high. This is the Hope window. If you'll notice there, Hope is holding an anchor in her hands. The anchor is a very early Christian symbol that has been found in the catacombs. It brings together the cross and the various nautical Christian symbols. And the anchor itself symbolizes hope in Christ. In this window, Hope, the anchor itself, two lines in the anchor are made of translucent stained glass rather than the opaque stained glass. And in the previous window, Faith, the light at the end of the oil lamp, the flame at the end of the oil lamp, is done in transparent glass as well, I believe intentionally. And when the sun shines through, the oil lamp itself seems to be on fire. And when the sun shines through this, it's sort of a navigational clue as to where the sun is at any point in the day. And this is the last of the three virtue windows, Charity. Charity is sometimes symbolized as a heart, but here Charity is holding a young child close to her heart. Charity is also known as love. Of particular interest in this window are Charity's feet. She is wearing two sandals, and each is different. You can tell from the glass and the aging on the glass and the colors in the glass that they were both created at the same time. And so there's probably some symbolism there, but I'm not sure what it is. Renaissance Art Gallery is housed in one section of the second floor of this building. We have held art dinners here in our dining room where guests can eat dinner and stay for the art show which follows. In addition to the stained glass windows of this building, I would like to show you some of the original oil paintings which adorn our walls. This is an oil painting by Simon Dinkovich, entitled Lady Lying Abed. Simon was born in September of 1950. He He was born in the Ukraine, formerly a part of the USSR. In 1968, Simon was admitted to the prestigious University of Kharkov. In 1996, Simon Dinkovich moved to the United States as a permanent resident. However, he spends about 85% of his time painting art in the city of Kharkov. Simon married the renowned artist Irene Ruskol in 1979, and he states that my wife is the one who gives me the most artistic inspiration and guidance. And when I look at this lady lying in bed, I often wonder if indeed it may be his wife. Here we are. This is my husband's office. That's my husband, Leonard Cefalo, right there, owner. The three wonderful windows which are behind him show beautiful afternoon sunlight. And I always think it's easier to become inspired when you can work in a room with three magnificent stained glass art windows. I hope that you've enjoyed learning today about stained glass and its beauty, mastery, and its place in the world of art. We invite you to come in and look at these wonderful windows for yourself. Many of them are backlit so that in the evening you can still enjoy the true beauty of each window. We're open here at Cefalo's Tuesday through Saturday at 5 p.m. for dinner, happy hours, and live entertainment on weekends. Sundays and Mondays are usually special or private events. We hope that one day you'll join us. On behalf of the entire Cefalo family, my husband Len, my son Dean, who was in the kitchen while we were filming and is our executive chef, my daughter Dana, who makes beautiful artistry with her fabulous voice here on the weekends, my gorgeous daughter Lauren and her husband John, the entire Cefalo family invites you to stop down and visit us. We look forward to meeting you. Thank you.
It is difficult for every person to enjoy every piece of art, but we have the freedom to choose what we like and what we don't. I hope you have enjoyed the experience. If you're an artist out there and would like to join our show or have any ideas for us, please contact me, Patricia Anthony, at 412-835-0649. As always, please remember our troops serving in the Middle East. We wish them a speedy and safe return.